Not gonna be very long. Lord always, He'll continue whatever we start today. Since we have a lot of visitors, I don't know anything about you, I have to say a few things. Number one, I want you to know how thrilled we are to have you here today. It's such a blessing that you're here. But secondly, I want you to understand that Jesus Christ is a real person.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
He is alive,
yes, sir.
And He's not dead.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
There is more evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ than just about any historical figure that you believe in.
Amen.
He rose from the dead.
Amen.
Now, what does that mean? What does that mean, He rose from the dead? I want you to know it's not a mythical thing. It's not like Santa Claus. It's not even like that Easter Bunny in the mall. He rose from the dead.
Yeah.
What that means is anybody that has beat that box, you bow down to. And you worship them as God.
Yes.
For that is who He is.
Yeah.
He is God Almighty, and He alone is God. Amen.
Amen.
It's wonderful that He rose from the dead.
Hallelujah.
I don't know about you, but I've got a lot of friends that are on the other side. Got a mom on the other side. Got grandparents on the other side. Right? And I want to see them again.
Amen.
You know, whenever you get around to, whenever I leave this earth and you bury me on my tombstone, I want you to put, not here.
That's right.
And then, do not stand over this grave. It may open at any moment.
All right.
And there will be an explosion because He rose from the dead.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to know He's real. So many people, even in the church world, act like Jesus is a myth. We live like He's a myth. We act like, you know, oh yeah, that's a, you know, when I was born at the church, they used to say this, and even as a little kid, I wasn't saved, I wasn't born again, but I hated it. They used to say back in Bible days, y'all remember that? And I thought, wow, they were talking about they read all these miracles that Jesus did. And they'd say, but that was back in Bible days. And I thought, well, that's not good. Man, I wish I'd lived back in Bible days. Because evidently, all He used to do, He don't do no more. Oh no, He's still alive.
Amen. Amen.
He's still a carrier.
Yes.
There's people who see Jesus every day.
Yes.
They really are.
Yes.
They see Him every day. I've got friends that have seen Him, and I have no reason to question their integrity because of the caliber of their life. Amen. I remember when I met Him. I didn't see Him. But let me tell you something. I already experienced. How many of you have already experienced some of this resurrection?
Yeah. Amen.
You know, I was dead in my trespasses and sins. I want you to know something. You know, they talk about sweet sinners and, you know, good sinners. I was an awful sinner. I was thoroughly lost. Thoroughly soaked in iniquity and sin. As low down as you could get. And yet I called on that name. And in a split second,
yes.
I came alive unto God.
Hallelujah.
I experienced resurrection power on the inside of me.
Yes.
In a split second. And let me tell you something. He is more real to me than anybody I see out there this morning.
Amen.
He has walked with me. He's never forsaken me. He's with me 24/7.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Go with me to Matthew chapter 27. It says, now as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross. And when they had come to a place called Golgotha, that is to say, a place of a skull, they gave him sour wine mingled with gall to drink. But when he had tasted it, he would not drink. Then they crucified him, divided his garments, casting lots that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Sitting down, they kept watch over him there, and they put over his head the accusation written against him. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. You know what's so amazing about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ? We all know they murdered an absolutely innocent man.
Yes.
He stood before Pilate. Pilate said, what is truth? Pilate was looking at truth. And God would not even allow his accusers at his death to put a lie over top of him. How many of you know he's the King of the Jews?
Amen.
He was then, he still is, and I don't know about you, but he's my King too.
Amen.
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 Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and another on the left. And those that passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who destroyed the temple and built it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." Likewise, the chief priests also mocking with the scribes and elders said, "He saved others, himself he cannot save. If he is the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now, if he will have him, for he said, I am the Son of God." Even the robbers who were crucified with him reviled him with the same thing. Now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness over all the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Some of those who stood there, when they heard that, said, "This man is calling for Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed, and offered it to him to drink. The rest said, "Let him alone. Let us see if Elijah will come to save him." And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earthquake, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened. And many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised, and coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. You know, if that was the end of the story, that'd be an awful thing, wouldn't it?
Yes.
That's not the end of the story.
Amen.
Matter of fact, that's the beginning of the story.
Yes.
Go and look at Matthew 28. I'm going to start at verse 28. Now I'm going to start at verse 1, excuse me. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here."
Hallelujah.
He is risen.
Lord.
Put yourself there for just a minute. You know, one of the things the devil has done to the church with great effect is he has robbed us of our imagination.
Yes.
The devil, it can be kind of prophetic at times. He can kind of see, get a glimpse of the direction God is going in. And so what he did is he gave the New Age movement a lot of things about imagination that were satanic and evil and wicked. And so Christians are afraid to use their imagination, not realizing they're using it all the time. You can't not use it. It's there. It's in you. Right? Most people get depressed and they get beat down. Why? Because they begin to let their imagination do things, but they don't dare use it for what it's designed for. Put yourself right there for just a moment. Put yourself in Mary Magdalene's place. She loved him. He had cast 7 devils out of her. He had rescued her from a life of sin and evil. And she knew that he was a godly man, had never done one sin, not one thing had he ever done wrong. And they murdered him, they butchered him worse than they would any other criminal. And not only did they kill him, they hated him while they were doing it. They reviled him. They cast insults upon him. Isn't it enough just to kill a man? You know, even today when they execute a prisoner, they don't let the family go in there and spit on him, do it. Because they realize this is the punishment. This is enough. But it wasn't enough for the Savior. They had to revile him. They had to do all that. And then walk up to that tomb. Feel the earth shake. See that stone roll away. And for an angel's sake, He's not here. He is risen. Ooh, that make a Baptist shout.
Amen.
Might even make an Episcopalian run.
All right.
You know, it might even get some charismatics to move a little bit. You know, so, woo! He's alive! He's alive! He's alive! He's not dead! He is alive! And the time the Church of Jesus Christ started acting like it again.
Amen.
Amen.
Really, you don't come in here to have a service and worship a God far off. You worship a God who walks with you and talks with you. You know, like the song says, a long last arrow. He's with you 24/7. He never leaves you. He is alive. You have conversation with him.
Amen.
How many of you talk to Jesus today?
Amen.
Now come on, don't get scared on me. How many of you talk back to today?
Yes.
He talks, he walks, you can feel him. That's why there was such an excitement up here this morning.
Yes.
People begin to get a glimpse of the tomb.
Amen.
He's alive.
Thank you.
He's alive. You need to meditate on it. Don't let your imagination dwell on, life is this and life is that. This is going wrong. Don't let your imagination go there. The Bible says a man and a woman think in their heart, so are they.
Yes.
You know, let your imagination, that's what you think in your heart, it's in your imagination. Let your imagination see the risen Savior and what that means to you.
Yes.
It means something. It means something. Hallelujah. Come see the place where the Lord lay and go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And indeed he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring his disciples word. Let me tell you something about you, Jesus, now. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them saying, rejoice.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah.
How many of you know Jesus probably had a few things he needed to take care of? But he is moved by your compassion.
Amen.
He's moved when you're broken and you're weak.
Yes, sir.
He couldn't, he had to stop that. Now, don't let that King James word throw you off. I mean, I don't think Jesus was standing there. Rejoice.
Amen.
Rejoice. You know, used to know a guy, he was the most dead man fellow I ever met in my life. He'd walk up to it, but he always looked sad. He always looked down the mouth. I used to ask him, I said, how are you doing today? He'd say, I'm overcome with joy. If I was any happier, I couldn't stand it. What was sad, he meant it. He really had it. But can you imagine Jesus saying, I believe he walked up to him. You know, he kept telling him, how many's read the book? He kept telling him, 3 days. His disciples, they're walking him away. He's telling the guards, you'll take my life. I'll lay it down. I believe he looks back at the disciples and says, 3 days.
Yeah.
3 days. What did he tell them? I'm rising from the dead. He announced it before he went. I'll be back. 3 days. And I believe they had heard him, but how many of you know it's hard to fathom it? Hard to get a mind wrapped around it. And I believe when he saw Mary Magdalene, I believe he had a smile that just lit up the world. And he looked at him and said, rejoice. I believe, how many of you know that every word that's said is not in the Bible? I believe I told you that. 3 days. Rejoice. Amen. Mary Magdalene wasn't the only one to see him, was she? The 11 seen him. Paul seen him as one born out of time. Paul said at one time, 500 people saw him at one time. He walked the earth for 40 days after that resurrection to prove beyond any doubt that he rose from the dead. Ate with him, talked with him. Good, 24/7. It's amazing. Let's look at John 11. You mentioned this morning, Annette. 24 and 25. Martha said to him, talking about Lazarus, that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. How many know Jesus said, "I am the resurrection before you ever did"?
That's right. Yes.
I am the resurrection and the life. Now, I'm fixing to go somewhere here in just a minute. Let me read this. I wrote down so I wouldn't forget it. Jesus has not risen from the dead, yet he declares, "I am the resurrection and the life." You have not yet risen from the dead, but if you are born again, the resurrection and the life is already dwelling in you.
Amen.
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 Come on, man. Y'all were Haganites and Colvinites. Don't y'all confess every day? Greater is he that is in me than he that liveth in the world. Don't you know he's inside of you? Matter of fact, one scripture said that Godhead dwelleth bodily in us. So there's resurrection life inside me right now. Amen. I don't have to wait to get to heaven to experience it. Now I know there's going to be a resurrection from the dead, but I want you to know there's resurrection power at work in you this morning, right now. Right now. Amen. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 says, "But what things were gained to me," is the Apostle Paul talking, "these I count loss for Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in Christ, the righteous of not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness is, which is from God by faith." Now listen to what Paul says,
"Amen.
That I may know him." And the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead.
Amen.
Now, how do you know, if you go back to Corinthians, Paul is making a debate with some people in the letter, saying some people said the resurrection has already passed. Why? And he goes into great detail, the most detail we have, how this resurrection is going to occur. There's going to be a trumpet blast. When you hear Prophet Tyrone come here with that shofar, that is the instrument. It'll be a ram's horn from heaven, but that is the instrument that you will hear. That trumpet will sound. There will be the teruah gadol, that last great blast that you'll hear. And man, every grave's going to open, we're going to be resurrected. But Paul's saying, "I will attain to the resurrection of the dead." Well, Paul said, "We're going to attain to the resurrection of the dead." So I think Paul's talking about understanding what's inside of him right now. He says, "I want to know him." You realize this man wrote half the New Testament?
Amen.
13 books of the New Testament he wrote. And he's saying, "I want to know him."
Yes.
How many think we might want to know him a little more?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And then he says, "And the power of his resurrection." Power of his resurrection. What's Paul talking about? I think Paul was strained with everything in his mind to get outside of his mind. I share this all the time. I was laying up here, I think it was while we were in the other church, laying on the floor one Sunday morning. God said, "If I can just get you out of your mind, I can do something for you." Now, I know a lot of you think I'm out of my mind now, but I'm really trying to get out of my mind. Now, what does that mean? Our brain tells us, you know, we live in a natural world and we call ourselves natural men. But you know, God said, Paul said, "You die right here, man." What was he trying to tell us, church? We're not. There's this resurrection power. What does it mean? You know, for the most of the church, it means one thing. That when that trumpet sounds, we'll go to heaven.
Hello.
That's wonderful. That's pretty awesome. That's pretty awesome. What do you think birthed you into the kingdom of God?
That's right. That's not fun.
What do you think birthed you into the kingdom of God? Resurrection power.
Amen.
Because you've already experienced the resurrection power. But God wants us to come into a place where we can walk in that resurrection power right now. Because the world needs it. The world doesn't want religion.
Amen.
They don't want religion. There's religion for, I mean, there's a, people got their own kind of, there's a makeup religion.
That's right.
Now they want to see a living Savior. And it has to be demonstrated to a people who understand resurrection power. And that's what we're trying to get to. But we have to get out of our mind a little bit to do it. Amen? I want to talk about some things you start doing right now to begin to experience the power of the resurrection life that's inside of you. These are just normal, everyday things. But I want you to be like Paul every day from this day forward. I want you to say, God, I want to know you. Jesus, I really want to know you. I want to know the power of your resurrection that's inside of me. What does it mean when we say grave? What does it mean when God says grave? Because he is in you, but he is in the world. That means every devil and hell you walk up to, every situation and every circumstance you walk up to, you are more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus who lives in you right now. This is that which overcomes the world. What? Even our faith. Faith in what? Faith in a God that's far off? No, faith in a God who's right here, resident inside of us. We have to grasp it, church. We have to begin to wrap our minds. We have to get outside the box. I hate to say it, that the Church of Jesus Christ has put us in. What's the first thing they tell you when you get born again? You can't be like Jesus. I beg your pardon.
Come on.
I beg your pardon. Find that in the Bible. Find me one scripture in the Bible that says you can't be like Jesus.
Come on.
No, matter of fact, the Bible says you're supposed to be exactly like
Jesus. Amen.
Matter of fact, Jesus says, the works that I do shall you do also, and greater works than these shall you do, because I go unto the Father.
Yeah.
We read that, we understand it, our mind gets it, but then something inside of us, our natural mind, this box called our brain, rises up and says, ain't nobody be like Jesus. Jesus came as the prototype to show us how to live.
Amen.
Yes, he did.
This is the way you walk. This is the only way you're going to upset the kingdom of darkness, is when we begin to get, and we've got to get our minds outside of the box and grasp. We've got to begin to believe what God says.
Yeah.
How many of you know that a lot of times you read the Bible, you read what it says, but then you've got a religious little thing inside your mind that interprets what you read. How many of you have ever read that scripture? Narrow is the gate, straight is the path.
Yes.
It leads to life. How many of you translate that right? Talking about heaven at all.
That's right.
Not one time to mention heaven. It's talking about a dimension you can walk in, very few walk in, called the God of life on this earth.
Yes.
It's what the apostles walked in, it's what God wants you and I to walk in. And we can do it once we accept the fact that the resurrected one lives in me, and he can't live in me without that resurrection power.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, it's hard, man. My brain just does flip-flops trying to get outside of it. That's what God spoke to me that day. You get out of, if I can get you out of your mind, what's the need to get me out of my mind? If I can get you out of your mind, will you believe what I say?
Amen.
Instead of what they told you to believe.
Amen.
I can do something. Amen?
Amen.
Don't wait. Here's the first thing you got to do. Don't wait till you get to heaven to use resurrection power. Use the God-given power to help you begin to overcome sin right now. What is sin? Let's forget adultery, fornication, homosexuality, lying, stealing. What does the word sin mean?
Miss the mark.
Missing the mark. You come short of the glory. What's the Bible say? All have come short of the glory. What was the glory he's talking about? What was lost in the garden? The glory. How many of you know God created Adam and Eve what? Naked in the garden. You ever wonder why all the ones after they sin, they come and they begin to try to cover themselves? How many of you know they were supposedly, quote, what we call naked all the time? But once they sinned, once they go out here, they begin to sow leaves. What were they covering? What did they lose? That's what we come short of. That's what sin causes us to do. Come short of walking in what God created us to be.
Yes.
Now, Jesus has come to restore us to that.
Yes.
So we have to begin to use that power. So how do we do it? Sin is a problem. We begin to repent daily. We begin to ask God to forgive us. We begin to cleanse ourselves. We don't become, you know, like a lot of people say, if you do that, you're going to become sin conscious. No, you're righteousness conscious. You're confessing your sin because you know you're the righteousness of God in Jesus Christ. You know you missed that little bit right there. So what you do is you repent and you get right back into that, pressing ever closer, using the resurrection power that's inside of you that's already conquered that problem to begin to liberate you and to set you free.
Amen.
Jesus wouldn't have come if we hadn't been bound. What bound is sin? Sin bounds. It's a cancer that affected the whole human race. But Jesus came to deliver us from it. Second thing you need to do is have a relationship and not religion.
Amen.
I'm not one of the people calling everybody else religious because I've been religious. It's easy to become religious. Let me tell you something. The Episcopalians ain't only religious folks. The Catholics ain't only religious folks. Pentecostals are religious. Charismatics are religious. And I don't care how free you are, you get religious in a minute. What is religion? It's when you begin to base your relationship on God with performance-based Christianity. I like the way Andrew Womack says that. What is performance-based Christianity? It's beginning, it's adding your law. It's when you come to a place where you begin to put a law in yourself of what it takes to please God. What's required of you to believe in Jesus Christ? When you boil it all down, what's required of you is to believe in Jesus Christ. To believe in anything and every circumstance that ever happens, you just believe in Jesus. And that pleases the Father. But you know what happened the moment I got saved? I read a book, How to Be a Really Good Christian. And to be a really good Christian, you had to read 10 chapters of the Bible every day, and pray an hour a day, you had to do this, you had to do that, you had to do all that. Well, I'm competitive. I read that, and I thought, well, I'll read 20 chapters. And I'll pray 2 hours. I won't be just a good Christian. I'll be a great Christian. And you know what happened every time I didn't read 20 chapters? I could read 19 chapters of the Bible, and you know what I felt like if I didn't get that 20 chapters? Felt like a failure. If I didn't pray 2 hours, I felt like a failure. You know what? I went from having this marvelous prayer time with Jesus where I was praying all the time, basically. Because how many of you know prayer is just simply talking to Jesus? Just walking through your life every minute, every second, every day. Just having a conversation with the Lord. Just loving Him. Lord, help so-and-so there. You know what they mean. I mean, it ain't getting down to the position. I mean, that's fine when we do that. But it's just having a relationship. Well, guess what? As soon as I was going to pray 2 hours a day, prayer became the worst thing, hardest thing that it was to do. Because I'd be looking at the clock. Let me know when I'm coming. I've been praying an hour and a half. And you don't want to think out loud because you don't want God to think you really don't want to be with Him. So you're trying to act religious. Oh God, I'm really enjoying prayer. Hallelujah. Oh, pray the Lord, Lord. And then as soon as you hit 120, God, and not pray the rest of the day. Because I got it done. Check. That's performance-based Christianity. Use resurrection power to break that. Get back into relationship. How many of you can remember what it's like when you first got born again? We're not supposed to lose that. Matter of fact, you're supposed to grow. Supposed to grow. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes. But religion will do that. If you're not careful, you'll put laws on your own self. This is how a Christian acts. This is how a Christian dresses. This is how a Christian walks. This is how a Christian wears their hair. This is how they do it. Amen. Make eternity your priority. Ask God to help you to see your life in this perspective. How many of you know we're eternal beings?
Amen.
We're here for, unless we get hold of the deeper revelation that we have right now, we're here for a very short time.
Yes, sir.
Even if you make the 120 or you break that record, you're here for a very short time. We've got to live with eternity in mind at all times. The power of the resurrection has to give us eternal focus. You know, you hear people say, well, they're so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. Well, you know what? That's not true. Most of the church is so earthly minded, they're worthless to heaven. All they're focused on is what's happening right here on the earth. They don't ever think about heaven. They don't think about their responsibility. They don't think about standing in Cleveland, the judgment seat of Christ, to give an account of what they've done in this life. They're just focused on what, you know, the kids and, you know, getting a job and how we're going to get retired and we're going to have enough money in the bank. You know, that's thinking about earthly things. Matter of fact, if you're going to obey Jesus, Jesus said, put your mind on things above.
Amen.
And not on things of the earth.
Yes.
Let resurrection power give us an eternal focus. Crucify self.
Yes.
Jesus said, if we're going to come after Him, we're going to have to die. That don't mean physically, it means soulishly. It means all the stuff I want that He don't want for me.
Amen.
All the stuff that I want that separates me from God. It separates me. Now I'll tell you something. This is for some big beer, because I'm telling you. You know why church has become such a drudgery? We're going to go back to religion. Because it's become a religious thing.